Brian Dirk is a professor of history at Anderson University in Anderson, Indiana. He received his PhD in history from the University of Kansas, where he was fortunate to have studied under the tutelage of the preeminent Civil War and Lincoln scholar, Philip S. Paladin. His first book, Lincoln and Davis, Imagining America, 1809 to 1865, was based on his dissertation, offering a comparative analysis of the two Civil War presidents' lives and careers. He has since focused most of his attention on Abraham Lincoln. He edited and contributed to a collection of essays entitled Lincoln Emancipated, the President and the Politics of Race. In 2007, he published Lincoln the Lawyer, an overview of Lincoln's legal career. Lincoln the Lawyer was awarded the Benjamin Baroness Award from the New York Civil War Roundtable for the best book published on Abraham Lincoln in 2007. In 2012, this year, he has published two books, Lincoln and the Constitution, as part of the Concise Lincoln Library series, and Lincoln and White America, an analysis of Lincoln's views concerning white supremacy and racism. And he's now working on the Vallandigham case and civil liberties. Brian Dirk.
Closer, too far away from the guest room. Okay, yeah. I'm a college professor, so I find that the louder I am, the more my students stay away in this room. Well, you know, it's pretty scary up here, actually. I'm surrounded by 40 federal judges and four stern-looking Roman men, I think, you know, and then preceded by five outstanding scholars. And to borrow Jack's metaphor, I'm sort of asked to be even closer, which is a little difficult when you're following what Johnson, you know, Carlton, Maddox, no, yeah, I suppose, right? It's a bit redundant, I think, because, to be honest with you, we've been discussing war powers all day. What we've been discussing, whether it be habeas corpus, martial law, even the 13th Amendment, Emancipation, have all the manifestations of Lincoln's war power. So when I was asked to speak here, I thought my best option would be to discuss that in a general way as a way to tie everything off. And you know, it's interesting how war powers is a term that gets rather easily bandied about by scholars who study Lincoln and the Civil War, and really Americans who study constitutional history in general. And this is so despite the fact that that phrase never appears in the Constitution. It is not in James Madison's notes from the Philadelphia Convention, nor does it appear in the Federalist Papers. For that matter, Abraham Lincoln himself only used the phrase war powers or war power a grand total of twice during the Civil War, and on neither occasion did he specifically tie it to the presidency, referring instead to the federal government's general war power. Nevertheless, there is a widespread assumption that Lincoln possessed in his disposal a thing called war powers. Singular. It lay rather like a tool in his constitutional toolbox, so to speak, readily assumed when he took office, requiring only his political willpower to wield the tremendous power. It was, constitutionally speaking, a tangible, readily available thing. All Lincoln had to do was pay it up. I think we see Lincoln in his war powers this way, because many of us gravitate towards the perspective of those Republicans and anti-slavery activists who urged Lincoln to use his war powers to free the slaves. Now, this idea actually possessed a very long pedigree, perhaps much longer than we suspect. All the way back in 1836, Congressman John Quincy Adams, in a speech on the floor of the U.S. House of Representatives, ironically enough, before House Speaker James K. Polk at the time, argued that in the event of a civil war, the federal government could interfere with the institution of slavery, quote, in every way by which it can be interfered with. He referenced international laws of war as an authority for this assertion, but he also referenced a rather vague but powerful, quote, war power lodged in the federal government by the U.S. Constitution. Now, these remarks, it's amazing when you think about it, that he could foresee the future that clearly from that far back. But these remarks were widely disseminated in anti-slavery circles during the 1840s and 1850s. And one of the people who remembered him was Charles Sumner. Right after the firing of Fort Sumter in April 1861, Sumner paid a personal visit to the White House, visited Abraham Lincoln, and specifically reminded him of John Quincy Adams' theory. He urged the president that, quote, under the moral power and the right that come to him to emancipate the slaves. Indeed, Sumner continued, the moral power was activated, gave Lincoln the constitutional authority to do whatever he thought necessary. Because Sumner, as he put it, quote, these powers would set in motion no moral law. Now there is also the perspective of William Wright, Lincoln's Solicitor General, who in the spring of 1862 wrote, the moral powers of the president and the legislative powers of Congress in relation to rebellion, treason, and slavery. Sounds like it would be a very, very long book. It was actually more of an overgrown pamphlet. Wright's pamphlet was primarily written to establish a legal rationale for the federal government's power to emancipate slaves. As Carol Hyman and Weissach pointed out, Wright shifted the traditional American thinking about the Constitution away from viewing the document simply as a collection of negatives, what the federal government was not allowed to do, and more toward the discussion of what the government's positive powers are to prosecute a vigorous and successful war. Taken together, the arguments of Adams, Sumner, and Whiting seem to constitute a viable moral powers doctrine upon which Lincoln could draw. In other words, they seem to assemble that moral powers tool and place it in Lincoln's toolbox, ready for his use. But upon closer examination, this is not really true. If we go back and read John Quincy Adams' 1836 speech, he references congressional moral powers and congressional action on slavery. He did not directly address the presidency at all, and in fact was more interested in providing internationalist context, the rather vague laws of war, as a possible justification for future emancipation, should someday America find itself confronted with a civil war between North and South. And his suggestion that the federal government could, without much hesitation, free Southern slaves, was, well, since 1836, widely considered an almost more radical radicalism, embraced by anti-slavery types, but very few others. So was Sumner's wholesale assertion of a moral power that gave Lincoln, in effect, a blank check. When Lincoln received Sumner's advice, his response was less than enthusiastic. He told Sumner blandly that he could not well afford to pursue such a course politically, lest he lose the border states. When Burke leaked to the press of Sumner's argument, he was, like Adams, excoriated in the press as a dangerous radical, asserting the existence of a failing moral power to, in effect, create what we would call a imperial presidency. It was very clear to Lincoln that to pursue this line of constitutional reasoning ran enormous political risk. Not only conservative billionaires, but even moderates within his own party, swarming uncomfortably at the implications of granting Lincoln a fuzzily defined moral power, particularly one that seemed not to be firmly anchored in the Constitution's clear black and white language. There was, quote, not a syllable in the Constitution conferring on the president war powers, Republican Congressman Lyman Trumbull observed, and even Charles Sumner seemed to back off his position in the interest of maintaining legislative prerogatives, stating later in the war that to Congress, quote, belongs any power of the government to be exercised in war, while the president, quote, was only used to move Congress. Even William Wright was less valuable to Lincoln than we might think. Wright's particular locus for the government's constitutional authority to emancipate was a very broad interpretation of Article 1, Section 8's mandate to provide for common defense and general welfare of the nation, a power that was specifically conferred on Congress. Wright devoted little actual attention to the question of the president's general war powers, along with footnote at the end of Chapter 3, which he prefaced with the statement that, quote, it is not my intention to explain the general war powers of the president. He then observed that in his constitutional authority to direct military operation, the president is, quote, responsible to and controlled by no other department of government. He then offered a long laundry list of possible wartime measures, martial law, suspension of habeas corpus, and so on, followed by the rather bland observation that, quote, whatever a commander-in-chief, in accordance with the usual practice of carrying on a war among civilized nations, may order his army and navy to do, it is within the power of the president to do, unquote. I would suggest then that despite Sumner's appearances, Adams, Sumner, and Whiting did not provide much help or political cover for Lincoln in figuring out just what his constitutional war powers were. Lincoln pretty much had to do that all on his own. and have worked with. While we read the Constitution, the president's ability to conduct a war rests almost exclusively on one brief sentence in Article 2, Section 2. Quote, the president shall be commander-in-chief of the Army and Navy of the United States and of the militia of several states when called into the national service of the United States. And that's it. At least as far as explicit constitutional language is concerned. Now, of course, there are other passages containing latent presidential war powers, but the actual ink on paper guidelines for Lincoln were extremely sparse. The framers devoted far more attention to the machinery for the presidential election, for example, than to his war-making responsibilities. Nor did they provide much in the way of clarification during their deliberations in Philadelphia concerning what they thought their newly minted American president should and should not do in time of war. Those familiar with the ongoing controversies over who can initiate or declare a war know that the founders devoted a fair amount of attention to that particular question, at one point substituting the word declare rather than make war as a way of allowing the president some space for acting militarily in this time of sudden emergency without seeking Congress's prior approval. Now, these arguments don't tell us much at all, though, about what the president is supposed to do once a war has actually begun. Nothing of the sort appears elsewhere in the Constitution. As far as we can tell, judging from Madison's notes, the subject never even came up in Philadelphia, which is rather surprising when you consider the number of men in that room who had experience with the recently concluded American Revolution. Now, one could argue that they did create at least the skeletal outlines of Congress's war powers. Article 1, Section 8's delineation of Congress's powers to raise and equip armies, make the necessary rules and regulations to govern those soldiers, and to issue letters of marque, and make rules concerning naval captures on land and water. Now, that still isn't much, but it is far more than what they saw fit to do in the present. The Federalist Papers were the most well-held, largely because their authors were, understandably enough, in the political climate of the day, much more interested in stemming Americans' worries about possible presidential misconduct and abuse of power than they were in explaining in detail what the president might be capable of doing in a time of national emergency, like war. Even if they had thought it necessary to create a blueprint for presidential war powers in 1787, it probably would not have been politically wise to do so, playing right into the hands of anti-federalist critics who saw in the executive branch a tyranny that was just waiting for a right moment to erupt. Consequently, on those few occasions in which they broached the subjects, the authors of the Federalist Papers, surely Alexander Hamilton, devoted their attention largely to explaining what a wartime president could not do. In Federalist Number 24, Hamilton tried to soothe the old American fear of a standing army by pointing out that the new American president could not raise a levy by himself. He needed Congress's help. And again, in Federalist 69, Hamilton tried to reassure Americans that they were not creating in the presidency a military dictatorship, arguing that the president's authority as commander-in-chief made him only, quote, the first general and admiral, unquote, and did not allow him total control over the raising and equipping of arms. Now, it all depended, in the end, upon the exact meaning of that phrase, commander-in-chief. Now, in theory, this seems pretty straightforward. The president gave orders to the military, and they carried out his orders. First general and admiral, as Hamilton put it. But of course, in practice, matters were not real so simple. Did the president possess literal power as commander-in-chief, for example, actually himself to take the field and command troops? George Washington thought so, and he came as close as any sitting president ever would to directly ordering troops to fire shots in anger when he personally led soldiers to crush the so-called Whiskey Rebellion in 1791, which fell apart before Washington could actually see battle. During the War of 1812, James Madison gave direct orders to the troops defending Washington, D.C., and by all accounts did a fairly effective job in doing so. But other than those two brief brushes with the battlefield, no other sitting president prior to Lincoln had exercised any sort of direct control over American troops. The Supreme Court had on occasion been called upon to rule upon the nature of the president's role as commander-in-chief, but only very, very occasionally. The handful of opinions handed down by the court related to war before 1860 mostly addressed congressional authority to authorize military action and what the possible consequences of that action might be in terms of settling prize cases on the high seas. And the presidency only figured into these issues rather than directly. Now, in your case, 1827, Mark v. Mott, the court ruled that a New York State militiaman could not simply refuse to obey President Madison's orders to prepare for an imminent British invasion of his state. We are all of the opinion, declared the court, that the authority to decide whether a military emergency had arisen belongs exclusively to the president, citing states as commander-in-chief, as well as admiral general provide for the common defense language. Now, this was useful enough, as far as it went. Still, when we add it all up, the language of the Constitution, the various commentators on the Constitution, like the Federalist Papers and the Supreme Court, this is all pretty thin and fair. On the day he took office, Lincoln knew he was the nation's commander-in-chief. As commander-in-chief, Lincoln could theoretically take the field, which was highly unlikely, aside from a wisecrack he once made in 1862, asking if General George McClellan had no intention of fighting, could be quote to borrow the army for a while. And I never quite figured out whether he was joking or not, and the mental picture of Lincoln actually trying to command troops in the field was a little hard to come by when you've gotten slain vampires these days, so heaven knows what he might have done. He could issue orders to the state militia and expect those orders to be obeyed. He was the nation's first general and first admiral, meaning that he could also issue orders to the national armed forces and expect those orders to be obeyed. But that's really about it. There was simply no war powers tool, in other words, in his toolbox. No war powers doctrine existed ready-made for his use when he took office. Lincoln had to fashion one himself. Now, I believe this was an ongoing, organic process throughout the war. He did not articulate his personal understanding of his war powers in any one particular place or one particular time. There is no war powers version of the Gettysburg Address, or one of those private letters meant for public consumption, the use of which he excelled. Instead, Lincoln rather quietly and carefully assembled a usable war powers doctrine from the various pieces available to him in the Constitution a little bit at a time. And he did so while avoiding the blank check approach advocated by John Quincy Adams and Charles Sumner. Lincoln actually needed, if not a blank check, at least a greatly expanded version of his war powers, greater than anything previously anticipated. But he needed to achieve this while avoiding as much as possible the heavy political costs that might ensue. And how did he do this? Now I argue in my recent book, Lincoln and the Constitution, that Lincoln was adept at tethering progressive ideas to specific constitutional language, the better to give those ideas concreteness, and he avoided vague abstractions that looked like overreaching. Before the war, for example, he avoided radical talk of a quote higher law than the Constitution, which provided a moral impetus to free the slaves. He knew talk of a higher law frightened many Americans because it seemed so vague it could justify pretty much anything. So when he made his own anti-slavery arguments, he tethered them to something far more tangible, the Declaration of Independence. He knew that most Americans accepted the Declaration as a readily identifiable, concrete symbol of the highest American values to which he could then tether calls for legal and constitutional reform. I argue that he did something similar with his war powers. As I pointed out earlier, the Constitution really has only one concrete specific provision for his war powers, his title of Commander-in-Chief. Now, Lincoln knew that every American agreed that he was, in fact, the Commander-in-Chief, if they didn't agree with what that meant. So I'm sure there was a political controversy there. So he very quietly and very subtly tethered broader and more expansive language about his war powers to that phrase. Note, for example, one of the first statements Lincoln released after the war began. His call for over 40,000 new volunteers to subdue the rebellion issued in early May 1861. A document most people don't really bother with because it's kind of in the Bill of Lading category of things. There's not much going on there. Now, Lincoln quite rightly said in the very first part of that document that he was doing this with his power as Commander-in-Chief. But appended to that were other less constitutionally specific and potentially powerful rationales. He claimed to be doing this because, quote, existing exigencies demand immediate and adequate measures for the protection of the national constitution and the preservation of the national union. At the end of the document, he added that he was also invoking these measures as a way of restoring, quote, the impartial enforcement of constitutional laws. Notice what Lincoln, the ever-careful wordsmith, an ever-savvy politician, is doing here. If he had merely stated
that he was calling out the volunteers only as commander-in-chief, well, that probably would have worked for that narrow purpose, but not much else. If, on the other hand, he had stated that he was calling out the volunteers only in the vague and ill-defined terminology of protecting the Constitution, preserving the Union, and law and order, he might well have been confronted by conservative critics who wondered just where in the Constitution he found such powers. Commander-in-chief was too narrow. Constitution, Union, enforcement against constitutional laws, too broad. So Lincoln did both, tethered them together, tied it all in a package, and said in effect, my authority rests in a war power that has both specificity and a broader idealism. Now, Lincoln habitually did this sort of thing throughout the war. It is instructive to look at the specific examples of his invocation of that phrase, commander-in-chief. I'm not sure I'm surprised. I went through the collected works and looked at the number of times Abraham Lincoln actually called himself commander-in-chief. And you would think there'd be quite a few examples, would you not? I mean, it's almost natural language. There's not. As a matter of fact, he was very careful whenever he used that phrase. And when he did, he would almost always tie it to other more controversial aspects of his war powers. When he rescinded General David Hunter's emancipation order in May 1862, he wrote that, quote, whether it be competent for me, as commander-in-chief of the Army and Navy, to declare the slaves of any state or states free, and whether at any time, in any case, it shall have become a necessity indispensable to the maintenance of that government, to exercise such supposed power are questions which, under my responsibility, I reserve to myself. Lincoln was here carefully coupling his commander-in-chief powers to that other, potentially very explosive assertion of his war-making authority, the power to free the slaves. This had the potential for controversy among those Americans prone to fearing presidential overreach. But by attaching his emancipation power to the explicit constitutional language of Article 2, Section 2, that he was the commander-in-chief, Lincoln was grounding himself. Whenever feasible, he used the phrase commander-in-chief as a clear constitutional anchor for emancipation. In his interview with the delegation of Chicago ministers urging him to free the slaves, an interview he knew would be widely reported in the press, he made it a point to muse aloud that, quote, as commander-in-chief of the Army and Navy, in time of war, I suppose I have a right to take any measure which may best subdue the enemy. And in all three emancipation documents, the first draft he shared with his cabinet in July of 62, the preliminary proclamation he issued on September the 22nd, and the final draft issued on New Year's Day, 1863, he likewise anchored all three of them in that commander-in-chief phrase. Whenever the subject arose, Lincoln liked to remind everyone that his actions were not rooted in some wispy abstraction like war powers, but in the specific and concrete language of the Constitution. In his famous letter to James Conkling in August 1863, defending emancipation, he again directly juxtaposed commander-in-chief with emancipation, writing, quote, you dislike the Emancipation Proclamation and, perhaps, would have it retracted. You say it is unconstitutional. I think differently. I think the Constitution invests in its commander-in-chief with the law of war in time of war. Now, it could be argued that this was accidental, that it was so natural for Lincoln to call himself commander-in-chief that he did so without much of a thought. Maybe, but I doubt it. If we know anything about Abraham Lincoln, is he was not a careless speaker and not a careless writer. Lincoln actually very rarely used commander-in-chief for original documents. I found only three examples. He used it in one of the proclamations of Thanksgiving and a couple of the cases. He very often used it much more carefully and more specifically. Note, for example, his, quote, proclamation granting amnesty to soldiers absent without leave, issued on March 10, 1863. On the surface, it would seem to be one of those routine presidential orders, a public declaration that deserters who returned to their units by April 1, 1863, could avoid punishment for their behavior. But towards the end of the document, he added this section. And whereas evil disposed and disloyal persons, at sundry places, have enticed and procured soldiers to desert and absent themselves from their regiments, thereby weakening the strength of the armies and prolonging the war, giving aid and comfort to the enemy, and cruelly exposing the gallant and faithful soldiers remaining in the ranks to increased hardships and danger, I do therefore call upon all patriotic and faithful citizens to oppose and resist the aforementioned dangerous and treasonable crimes. Now, when you think about it, that last section is actually superfluous, unnecessary to the document's overall purpose, that of enticing soldiers back to their duty. It had nothing to do with those critics of the draft, Clement Vallandigham, for example, who would be arrested for urging resistance to the draft less than a month later, who were urging soldiers to desert. He didn't have to put that in there. It had nothing to do with the actual purpose of the document. But Lincoln was here signaling his intent to take a hard line with these people. And we know that in the spring of 1863, between the arrest of Vallandigham, the courting letter that we discussed on many occasions, he did indeed take a hard line. We know that he was going to take a hard line with these people, and in doing so, he would be venturing into the always constitutionally dicey area of suppressing those forms of dissent aimed towards actually depriving the military of recruits. It was still in 1863 an open question as to whether or not such suppression was an accepted part of the president's war powers, which is perhaps the reason that Lincoln used that phrase again, commander-in-chief, in the very first sentence of that document too, making the point that, in his opinion at least, suppressing those, quote, evil, disposed, and disloyal persons was an integral part of his powers as commander-in-chief. Commander-in-chief, in various ways and in various times, emancipation, conscription, and internal security, the three most controversial exercises of presidential war powers during Lincoln's tenure in the White House, were tethered to that statement, because that was all he really had to work with in the Constitution. In his own quiet, subtle way, Lincoln was here, in effect, making his own constitutional doctrine. He fashioned his own war-making tool, and he did so in his own inimitable fashion, combining a pragmatist appreciation for the political realities of his time with his own fierce determination to leave no means untried in winning the Civil War. We give Abraham Lincoln a great deal of credit for having the political and moral will to wield the war powers of the U.S. Constitution. And rightly so, I believe. There are those critics who refer to him in his day as a tyrant. I rather doubt that that is still the case, although you see it on occasion. But we do give him credit for his robust application of these powers. And I think we should go one step further. I think we should give Abraham Lincoln credit for being a fairly subtle and careful constitutional thinker in assembling these bits and pieces in what was a usable doctrine that was at once both grounded in real language, but at the same time had the potential to give him the power he needed to have to fight in some of the most controversial aspects of the Civil War in which he led this nation. Thank you. I think that's it. Thank you.